The aim of my talk today is really twofold. That's first to explore US democracy promotion initiatives with particular reference to Venezuela. And the second aim is to demonstrate really a challenge to US hegemony in the region surrounding this notion of democracy. So the two principal actors that I'm obviously going to be talking today about are really Caracas and Washington. And I'm going to make the case that Venezuela is important to this story for two reasons, and it's really these two reasons that are going to structure my talk today. The first reason is that through particular depictions of Venezuela, this really enables Washington to classify the Americas. For example, an authoritarian Venezuela is placed in contrast to a democratically abiding Latin America and a democratically promoting United States. That is to say that within this vision, Washington becomes the democratic standard bearer for the region, with the rest of the Americas either following or corrupting this model. So that's the first point that I'll speak to a bit later. The second point is that it's going to focus on the Venezuelan challenge to this understanding of democracy. And it does so, I'm going to argue, by extending an understanding of what constitutes politics. In so doing, I'm going to try to make the case that it's undermining not only US attempts to both order and classify the Americas, but it's also undermining the legitimacy of US democracy promotion initiatives throughout Latin America. So that's the aim of that. So part one, an authoritarian Venezuela. While depictions of Chavez as an autocrat really originate in domestic opposition to the 1998 presidential campaign, the tenets of this criticism are very much picked up upon and expanded by US officials. The US Senate in 2010, for example, proposed Resolution 428, in which it declared, and I quote, "Hugo Chavez has systematically weakened democratic institutions in Venezuela by restricting individual rights and the activities of political parties, discouraging the free exchange of ideas, and centralizing and expanding the powers of the executive over other branches of government and the people of Venezuela. Moreover, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton has described Chavez as a democratically elected leader who does not govern democratically, and former President Bush called Chavez a man who was elected by the people but does not respect the democratic institutions of his country." So while arguments of authoritarianism potentially appear hard to sustain in the face of 14 free and fair elections in Venezuela, dictatorial representations continue to retain their currency in Washington. A potential explanation for this positive reception may lie in the authoritarian thesis's capacity to demarcate a totalitarian Venezuela from a freedom-exporting United States. While autocratic characteristics reviled amongst the US public, the betrayal of Chavez as a crazed dictator stands in contrast to the perceived role of Washington in the United States, in Latin America, sorry. Benevolent and paternalistic, the belief of the United States is both the guiding light and the active promoter of democracy throughout the Western Hemisphere is not only predicated on the exclusion of Venezuela, but also enacts a particular Latin American democratic ideal. Such effects, I argue, were apparent in President Bush's 2005 address to the Summit of the Americas in Fort Lauderdale, and I quote, "In the new Americas of the 21st century, bringing a better life to our peoples requires choosing between two competing visions. One offers the vision of hope. It is founded on representative government, integration into world markets, and a faith in the transformative power of freedom in individual lives. The other seeks to roll back the democratic progress of the past two decades, by playing to fear, pitting neighbour against neighbour, and blaming others for the failure for their own failures." Through these representations, Washington divides the region into a democratic vision of hope and a thinly veiled reference to Venezuela, a competing authoritarian ideal. With democracy and freedom proclaimed as the hallmarks of the US vision, an authoritarian Venezuela clearly sits outside of this community. Chavez becomes the illiberal anomaly in the democratic Americas, with inter-American relations structured by competing logics of freedom and totalitarianism, a remarkable consistency with the ideological struggle that underpinned the Cold War. An authoritarian Venezuela, in this sense, acts to discipline other Latin American states by domesticating a particular type of democratic behaviour at the expense of any other form that deviates from the US model. US reactions to participatory democracy in Venezuela is a case in point. Deriding the elections that installed a new constitution and National Assembly within Chavez's first years in office, the former Undersecretary of State for Western Hemispheric Affairs, Peter Romero, claimed that in Venezuela you do not see a government of rules, only plebiscites, referenda, and more elections. These criticisms are not limited to Caracas. In reference to both Venezuela and Bolivia, two countries that have enacted constitutional reform to enable greater popular participation, President Bush told reporters that, "I'm concerned about the erosion of democracy in these two countries," he mentioned. Any experimentation or departure from the authorised democratic model is identified as a corruption and a potential threat to democratic consolidation in the region. To admit the democratic authenticity of Venezuela within this model would not only undermine the veracity of the authoritarian thesis, but would also affect the key element around which Washington constructs its vision for the Americas, that is, the United States and not Venezuela as a democratic standard bearer. So more than merely rhetoric, however, it is in accordance with this logic that Washington is able to intervene in the region via its democracy promotion initiatives. One of the principal bodies through which Washington funds its democracy promotion is the National Endowment for Democracy, or NED. While their activities extend beyond the Western Hemisphere, in relation to Venezuela, NED perpetuates the authoritarian thesis and promotes its services as a cure to this problem. NED President Carl Gershman, for example, in 2002, spoke before the US Senate and repeated his organization's classification of Venezuela as a semi-authoritarian state. And clearly sharing the official US view, it was in 2002 that Venezuela became the greatest recipient of NED funding, or programs for Venezuela became the greatest recipient of NED funding. In addition to fostering relations with local opposition groups, NED attempts to refashion Venezuelan democracy below, and this also extends to USAID programs. In 2006, for example, the US Senate Appropriations Committee defined promoting democracy to include, and I quote, "programs that support good governance, human rights, independent media, the rule of law, and otherwise strengthen the capacity of democratic political parties, NGOs, and citizens." So with good governance concerning the executive and legislative branches, law and human rights falling under the purview of the judiciary, and concerns regarding the media ensuring the monitoring or intervention into the fourth estate, really every strata of society becomes an element or becomes a target for democracy promotion. Beyond the confines of Caracas, however, Washington has explicitly sought to institutionalize its democratic vision within the OAS, via its Declaration of Florida, delivering the benefits of democracy. Described as a democratic early warning system, the proposal exhorted the Permanent Council to, and I quote, to develop a process to assess, as appropriate, situations that may enable the development of a member state's democratic political institutional process and or legitimate exercise of power. While there were concerns initially raised of the potential for US intervention under the aegis of democracy, Secretary Rice was quick to clarify the proposal. "This is not a matter of intervening to punish," she argued. However, far from dismissing the possibility, she continued, "it's a matter of intervening to try and sustain the development of democratic institutions across the region." More than monitoring regional democracies, the significance of the Declaration would be to institutionalise a particular conception of democracy. The surveillance of each country's political systems would normalise a specific US-authored form of democracy, with any variation scripted as inferior and thereby worthy of further oversight. Oversight would consequently become a strategy for making regional actors aware of the correct model. The US brand of representative democracy consequently becomes the standard from which it is possible to qualify, classify, and punish other Latin American states. Ultimately, however, and this is where things get interesting, this initiative failed. The Brazilian foreign minister at the time, Celso Amorim, for example, told Secretary Rice that democracy is not imposed. It is born from dialogue. While the Venezuelan OAS ambassador, Jorge Valero, stated that there will be no acceptance in the heart of the Americas for any proposal that means trying to impose a single democratic model. The most forceful criticism, however, surrounded the potential for US intervention under the name of democracy, in the name of democracy. And I quote, "Anything that looks like an intervention in the internal affairs of another country," claimed Venezuelan Foreign Minister Ariel Rodriguez, "will meet with certain resistance from Venezuela and the vast majority of Latin American states." So while this rejection within the OAS already suggests a limit to US attempts to impose its democratic vision on the Americas, I'm going to focus now more explicitly on the Venezuelan challenge to this, and hopefully that accentuates this notion of challenging US democracy, notions of American democracy in America. So part two. Although preceding the US declaration of Florida, Venezuela has sought to institutionalize an alternative democratic model. Foreign Minister Ariel Rodriguez, for example, proposed the charter as a way of overcoming what he saw as an elitist democracy, a democracy that is merely electoral. When speaking of democracy, he asserted, the question is simple. There cannot exist a single democratic model. Questions of socioeconomic parity are obviously at the forefront of this Venezuelan proposal. And I quote Rodriguez again. Where the calamities of hunger and poverty exist, democracy is in doubt and human rights are a fiction. According to this view, without substantial reforms and the redistribution of economic assets, representative institutions, irrespective of their democratic value, are going to simply mirror the undemocratic power relations within society. However, to return to the inter-American sphere, despite the hostility to US attempts to promote democracy, the implementation of the social charter within the OAS is not yet realised, as discussions over its final makeup are ongoing. In a recent May 2011 meeting, an OAS working group convened to discuss the draft resolution. With comments still to be garnered from the General Assembly, the proposal still appears some way off ratification, if it gets that far. These limitations aside, however, abundantly clear is the extent over the struggle over the very notion of democracy within Latin America. At its most radical, Venezuela demonstrates a limit to US capacity to unify an understanding of democracy and fix it as an object over which it can monitor and control. US discursive and institutional power is challenged by highlighting another way of conceiving democracy and placing this understanding as a corrective to the US conception. Democracy consequently becomes a site of contestation, whereby Latin America is no longer the passive recipient of US knowledge. Accordingly, if notions of democracy are challenged, then so too is Washington's capacity to call the region to account for not following its democratic model. Exploring this reformulation in greater detail, central to the US narrative is the need to dismiss Venezuela so as to maintain the integrity of its democratic project in the region. Democracy promotion initiatives, combined with the dismissal of Venezuela, place Washington as the democratic standard bearer for the Americas. Rather than a naturally given attribute, however, this meaning is energized by less than equal representations of Latin American democracies. Implicit in its criticism of Venezuela, for example, is a belief that Washington is the democratic absolute against which the region is measured. Indeed, irrespective of the position taken, the superiority of the US model is affirmed, either through the presence of the US model in its implementation by a dividing Latin America, or in the danger associated with its absence. Democracy, I argue, becomes the ultimate classifier of Washington's vision of hope, both reaffirming an ordered Latin America and maintaining US leadership of the region. By promoting a different political path, however, Caracas disturbs the US understanding of democracy and the legitimacy, upon which it justifies its intervention. An understanding of Venezuelan democracy is not necessarily inferior, but as offering a different view of what constitutes politics, has the potential to rework US claims of being a democratic standard bearer for the region. Rather than viewing Latin American democracies as inferior or as in a process of following the US example, difference in this sense is recast as manifesting the possibility of an alternative way of viewing politics. As a result, Washington is forced to acknowledge a limit to its understanding of the region, the views that the Americas are the following or corrupting its knowledge. And I'll end there. Thanks.
Vancouver from Honduras in relation to this, and the American response to it as it developed throughout the process. How does it impact on both America's view of what democracy is and how the rest of the region perhaps starts perceiving America in terms of its democratic promotion?
You mentioned Alba before in your talk. Now, I think there was essentially three actors that were really involved. There was Latin America writ large, there was the United States, and there was Alba. So Alba was the first organisation to come out vehemently in condemnation of the events of the coup in Honduras in 2001. The US were less willing, well, they didn't call it a coup until something like 96 days after the event. Some of the reasons for which they claim enabled them greater leverage over the de facto Micheletti government, because if they were to call it a coup, then their faith only would have to stop. By not calling it a coup, they argued, they were able to leverage the potential to call it a coup at a later date to get them to come back to power, to reinstate Zelaya. Interestingly enough, however, more recently, the debate's kind of shifted to the reinstating of Honduras within the OAS. And this is where a schism within ALBA kind of appears. Venezuela, and interestingly enough, Santos and Colombia were at the forefront of getting the rest of Latin American states to support the readmission of Honduras into the OAS. Notably, another prominent member of ALBA, Ecuador, was at the forefront of opposing this. So while in 2009 ALBA may have appeared like a strong bloc in opposition to what was going on, come 2011 there was differences within that. I don't think that's necessarily a negative thing. But yeah, there's an interesting gap there. But to return to your question, I think that demonstrates that there was a different conception of what democracy was all about. The United States were less willing to call it a coup, and while it may have been seen as a means of, strengthening their hand during negotiations within the region, it was not looked so favourable. So, along that way.
You are interested in finding new subjects to do research. What I want to just to add to your presentation is that this discussion about representative democracy, participatory democracy, is quite old in Latin America. I remember in my generation we killed each other with this discussion. We used to oppose, at that time, formal against real democracy. So I think it would be very interesting to compare what is going on. And I'm glad that the discussion today is taking place in a pacific way, not like we did in the 70s.
That is
young. Yes. But also you may look at the discussion of the idea of republic. This is a very republic. We are not discussing about democracy. The idea is how to construct and defend a republican system in Latin America. Following the old Kantian idea, the sense that we have to defend separation of power, division of power, check and balance, and civil liberties. And this is part of a very strong discussion in many countries. In my country, in Argentina, I would say that this is the main political discussion we are having today. Not democracy, but republic.
To return to debates about democracy, that's definitely a criticism of Venezuela's participatory democracy that doesn't respect the traditional separation of power, the old Montesquieu model. I definitely didn't touch it on this paper, and it would be one more, but I don't touch on it too much either. More interested am I on how these ideas are playing out in Latin America, and I think what it does demonstrate is that there is a shift in an understanding of what democracy is all about within Latin America, and that appears, at this period of time at least, to conflict with what the US understanding of it is. But yeah, like you said, participatory democracy is an incredibly interesting phenomenon. And it is criticised at Venezuela model for this separation of powers. But I guess it depends on what we're going to be measuring it up against. If we're going to be measuring it up against liberalism, then I think it is probably right to criticise. But if we're measuring it up in terms of maybe greater social equality, then perhaps it's doing a better job. I guess it's just it's what we bring to it as much as what's happening.
So are there any other distinct characteristics from this Latin American democracy model you're talking about, other than what you just touched upon? Anything that compared to the US?
It's hard to, I'm loath to suggest that there's a Latin American democratic model. So I'll talk about the Venezuelan model, both because I don't want to group it all together and plus I want to hide my ignorance on the other models. So the Venezuelan model, it is criticised for breaking down the traditional separation between the executive and the legislative. I think you can make a pretty forceful argument that during the previous to when Chavez came to power, this separation was largely inexistent anyway, even though there were two different levels. But part of that is also a greater social level. So in the Venezuelan case, you've got a series of community councils, which involve greater popular participation in the democratic process. So that's one example of how a Venezuelan democratic model would be distinct from what the US sees as playing out. And then like the quote that I mentioned here, this idea of, you know, that's not government, that's just plebiscites, referenda and elections. That was the criticism coming from the US. So that was kind of interesting. Whereas now it's very much promoting this idea that there's, yeah, he may be elected democratically, but he's not governing in a democratic way. We can talk about it more, maybe pick up more on some of it.
My name's Jim, I'm a student at another institution. So thank you for AU for this opportunity to come and listen to the speakers. But specifically, I wanted to say that, you see, are we really actually having a discussion here about democracy, or is this actually the conception of the US conception helped along by others like Castaneda between the good left and the bad left? This, in a way, it's a US, although Castaneda is not American, but it's almost a US imposed view of Latin America. I don't think that, for example, Lula has been quite the same. How can you argue that Venezuela is not democratic? It's, if anything, it has an excess of democracy. Now, whether I agree with that statement or not, I'm not sure, but the point is that Latin American leaders are not being drawn into this discussion. So do you think we're actually having a discussion about democracy? Is it about democracy, or is it about this conception of good versus bad in order to reach Latin American states?
I think what I've talked about is the latter, this good, bad. I've very much focused on the US understanding of Latin American democracy, particularly Venezuelan democracy. So I haven't had this conversation about what democracy is all about. And I'd be loath to do it because I don't feel qualified enough to have it. I think I need to be on the ground to have that conversation properly to really, you know, get my head around what's actually happening there on the ground. So my interest in this paper has been, you know, very much the US reaction to and its attempts to impose its democratic model on Latin America. And it had some success in 2001. I think it was on September 12, 2001, or could have been September 11 or September 10. It was actually successful in institutionalising the Democratic Charter, I think it was called.
It was 11, the same day.
September 11, which is a document that it's impossible to forget. If you're talking about a Latin American model of democracy, that was not US imposed. It was a Peruvian initiative that Venezuela blocked for a year, and that sets the minimal conditions for democracy in the Americas. And I would actually challenge the idea that that was US imposed.
I'm willing to accept that. So what I looked at then was the US attempts to expand upon that. I think in 2005 with the Declaration of Florida, and the Venezuelan response to the 2001 model, which was seen as the social charter, which for the Venezuelan part was a corrective to the US model. So I think at this institutional level, this inter-American institutional level within the OAS, there's a kind of mini battle going on of the US understanding of democracy and the Venezuelan understanding of democracy. If I just take the two characters that I talked about today, and how they're both trying to I guess, curry favour amongst the rest of the the region. And that's more the story that I've focused on here. And that's when the good and the bad left, I think, is really important to keep in the back of our heads. So I agree with you on that point.
Going to abuse my position of the chair, I was at the committee in 2005, and it was the Brazilians who killed the stone dead.
Okay.
And it was remarkable that the American document came forward, everyone walked in, there was a problem. And Haladi released a document on democracy. So a regional integration trade bloc released a statement on what to do about a democratic statement. And by the time the meeting ended, there was no document. It didn't come out until I think it was a day and a half afterwards. So a couple of key countries stayed and just killed off everything they didn't like. Now, one thing I want to ask is about, so you're talking about almost like legitimacy of democracy. What's the legitimate way to think about it? Wouldn't it be a little more cynical and go to people like William Robinson, Paul Kamich, here in New Guzzi, and all the Morning Poly architects? Because there's a very strong literature about how the U.S. promotes one vision of democracy as a mechanism of social political control.
Absolutely.
So if we accept that, let's take it, but we'll take that assumption that that's right, do we have a contestation for power and influence?
Absolutely.
On a very material level, not on an ideal level, but who's going to decide how societies run, accumulation takes place?
Absolutely. I didn't have a chance to talk about in the presentation, but in the paper I touched on a little bit, the economic dimensions of this. And to bring it back to the ideology just for a second, the US vision of hope that Bush spoke to in 2005, there was an economic dimension to that as well. It was, yes, you know, they have to democratic promoting, blah, blah, blah. But at the same time, that there had to be this opening of economies and these sorts of things. Definitely within the Venezuelan example, there is a challenge towards that and that promoting polyarchy, like you said. If that then translates into specific area domestic opposition to the Venezuelan position, I'm not too aware of that. What it does translate into is that NED, very much the National Endowment for Democracy and other organisations, feeds into that discontent at the local level. But whether that plays out in the Venezuelan position at the end of the day within the OAS, I'm less sure. But that's definitely something I should explore.
This is more a logistical point. The acoustics are not amazing, so could everyone please try to project just a little bit more?
Can you hear me okay? So
yeah,
I can hear
you. It's the questions, which I'm really interested in, so would be good to hear. Thanks.
Yeah, and you too, John. I couldn't hear you.
Okay. If I could just follow up on what you were talking about the material basis of that, I think there's no need to separate the two and say this is just fluffy ideological stuff, but it's really the real meat of the matter is going underneath about the struggle for power. They're both inherently intertwined. You know, the ideas motivate how we see things and how we understand them. So it's a struggle on economic terms, on political terms, and on logical terms, and they're all sort of intertwined like that. And there's definitely, you know, it's definitely different conceptions of really not just democracy, but society altogether, and how we govern different aspects of society. So I think there's definitely, I think what Sean said, he's got a point in that. There, we shouldn't just think, look at one side, even just our logical side.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.